Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Gate to China, A New History of the People's Republic and Hong Kong, by Michael Sheridan, narrated by Nigel Patterson. Dramatis Personae, Chinese Leaders. Mao Zedong, 1893-1976, poet, revolutionary and political philosopher, a key founder of the People's Republic of China in 1949. Mao said that Hong Kong was an issue for the next generation to solve, bequeathing the task of its restoration to Deng Xiaoping. Deng Xiaoping, 1904-1997. Marxist and statesman, China's paramount leader from 1977 until shortly before his death. Deng opened the economy to the world and struck a deal over Hong Kong, but opposed political reform and crushed the democracy movement in 1989. Jiang Zemin, born 1926. The former Communist Party boss in Shanghai, Jiang took over as leader of the party, the state and the army after the crisis of 1989, holding power into the early 2000s. He oversaw the handover of Hong Kong and led China into the WTO. Hu Jintao, born 1942, China's leader from 2002 to 2013, served as Communist Party chief in Tibet, presided over the 2008 Olympic Games, and steered the country through a global financial crisis. Hu revived the role of the state and ruled as a low-key collective leader. Xi Jinping, born 1953, supreme leader of China from 2013, restoring the party's dictatorship. A princeling, son of veteran Xi Chongxun, served as governor of Fujian province, later vice president with responsibility for Hong Kong and Macau affairs. Key figures in the history of China and Hong Kong. Li Qiang, 1905-1990. A spy, bomb maker and lifelong militant, Li was China's foreign trade minister as the country began to open up. His visit to Hong Kong in 1978 paved the way for talks between China and Britain on the future of the colony. Liao Chengzhi, 1908-1983. Born in Tokyo, a wily and sophisticated revolutionary who was trusted by Mao and Deng to forge policy on Japan, Taiwan and Hong Kong. He is said to have invented the concept of one country, two systems. Xi Chongxun, 1913-2002. Joined the Communist Party in 1928, guerrilla leader in the first generation of revolutionaries. Purged by Mao Zedong, he returned to head the party in Guangdong province, pioneered reforms and special economic zones. Father of Xi Jinping. Zhao Ziyang, 1919-2005. Marxist-Leninist turned liberal reformer, served as Communist Party chief in Inner Mongolia and Sichuan, later premier. Became party leader 1987, purged 1989, died under house arrest in Beijing. His memoirs were smuggled to the West. Zhou Nan, born 1927. Ultra-patriot and ardent Marxist, China's main negotiator with Britain and Portugal over Hong Kong and Macau, later head of Xinhua in Hong Kong. An expert in English literature. Also served as ambassador to the United Nations, 1980-1981. Chu Rongji, born 1928. As mayor of Shanghai, Chu oversaw a peaceful end to 1989 protests. Later governor of the central bank and prime minister, he reformed financial sector, fought corruption, encouraged foreign investors, ran China's negotiations to join the WTO. Personalities in Hong Kong. Anson Chan, born 1940. The first woman and the first Chinese civil servant to lead the Hong Kong administration under British rule. At one time, the city's most respected public figure, Chan spoke up for democracy and was later denounced by China as a colonial lackey. Carrie Lam, born 1957. A Roman Catholic, Lam won promotion as an efficient administrator under the British and rose to become the fourth chief executive of Hong Kong. Her policies set off mass protests, and in 2020 she embraced China's national security law. Martin Lee, born 1938. Jesuit-educated barrister, revered as the founder of Hong Kong's Democratic Party and for his fearless rhetoric. He lost out to a younger, more radical generation of activists before his arrest in 2020 under the national security law. C.Y. Leung, born 1954. Third chief executive of Hong Kong, 2012 to 2017, Leung was unfailingly loyal to Beijing and was alleged to be an underground member of the Communist Party. His tenure was marked by protests, middle-class discontent, and dour inertia. Donald Tsang, born 1944. The son of a policeman, Tsang rose by merit to become financial secretary and later the second chief executive of Hong Kong, 2005 to 2012. A devout Catholic, he was later jailed for misconduct in public office. The charges were quashed on appeal. Tong Chi-hwa, born 1937. Shanghai-born shipping tycoon, picked by China as the first chief executive of the HKSAR, the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region, 1997 to 2005. Driven from office after mass protests and economic upheaval, his family firm was later sold to a Chinese state entity for $6.3 billion. Joshua Wong, born 1996. The teenage face of Hong Kong's youth rebellion, an evangelical Christian whose gifted oratory and digital skills inspired opponents of authoritarian rule. Jailed for his activities, he later faced serious charges under the national security law. The British. Percy Craddock, 1923 to 2010. British ambassador to China, later foreign policy advisor to Margaret Thatcher, and head of the Joint Intelligence Committee. Craddock masterminded the deal to hand Hong Kong back to China and warned against radical democratic reforms. Christopher Patton, Lord Patton of Barnes, born 1944. British Conservative politician, 28th and last governor of Hong Kong. Patton defied the wrath of China to introduce wider democracy. His reforms did not survive. Later European Trade Commissioner and Chancellor of Oxford University. Margaret Thatcher, 1925 to 2013. Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, 1979 to 1990. Duelled with Deng over the fate of Hong Kong, but conceded to his demands after winning guarantees that the territory's freedoms would endure for 50 years after the handover in 1997. David Wilson, Lord Wilson of Tilyawn, born 1935. Sinologist and diplomat, Wilson met Deng in 1979, negotiated the text of the Joint Declaration, and was 27th Governor of Hong Kong, 1987 to 1992. He carried out major reforms in politics, education, and infrastructure. Edward Yoder, 1924 to 1986. Served as a young diplomat in China, fluent in Mandarin, ambassador to the People's Republic of China, 1974 to 1978. Appointed 26th Governor of Hong Kong, 1982, admired by many Chinese for his scholarship, died on a visit to Beijing. A note on names. This is a book for the general listener. Therefore, Chinese names of people and places are given in the most widely recognized form. The pinyin system of transliteration has been used in most cases, with a few historical exceptions, such as Chiang Kai-shek. In Hong Kong, individuals may take a Western name in addition to their Chinese one, for example, Martin Lee Chu Ming. Some adopt initials as a preferred form of address, for example, C.Y. Leung. In all cases, the form most commonly accepted in the Hong Kong media has been observed. The Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation was generally known as Hong Kong Bank, especially in the colony, from its founding in 1865 until the bank instituted its global HSBC brand in the 1990s. In this book, it is referred to by the terms appropriate to the period. Introduction. Hong Kong, China. The skyline is a forest of towers that captures the eye from afar. The streets buzz, the hoardings blaze, and the noise deafens. The harbour is a scene of perpetual motion, uniting islands and peninsula. For hundreds of years, only a few settlements stood in these waters to mark the boundary between China and the world beyond. But in the 19th century, a band of piratical adventurers planted a flag and built their colony on a rock above a deep water anchorage. Today, it is one of the world's great cities. Hong Kong was the gate to China when the country lived behind a wall of isolation. Until late in the 20th century, a pilot could spot it from hundreds of miles off as he flew under night skies across a vast darkness. Airliners followed a corridor of radio beacons through empty quadrants of sky reserved for military aviation. Rolling south beneath the wings, towns in the People's Republic unfolded as pinpricks of light in a carpet of gloom. There were no superhighways, no high-speed trains moving like glowworms below. Long before the descent, at the point where the dim land gave way to the utter blackness of the sea, the crew saw a blaze of light that marked Hong Kong. Now the gate stands open. A pilot navigates above a sea of brightness, extending from central China down to the old treaty ports before dissolving in star showers across the Pearl River Delta. In four decades, the region has become the greatest industrial complex in human history. Hong Kong can only be picked out by its distinctive geography. By day, the approach is signalled by a dun-hued haze enveloping the cities, the islands, and the waterways. The city's politics and culture, too, are blending with those of mainland China, a slow saturation that seems as irresistible as the tides. Sailing in from the South China Sea, the mariner crosses a line where the water turns from aquamarine to murk. Here, the Pearl River spills into the deep, its turgid flow, laden with half the elements in the periodic table, leaching into the ocean. Ships bring raw materials from Africa, Australia, or Brazil, oil and gas from the Middle East, technology from Japan or South Korea, parts from across Asia, meat, fish, grains, and luxuries for Chinese consumers. They sail away with cargoes of manufactured goods for markets on every continent at prices to decimate the competition. The joint efficiency of container ships and Chinese factories has transformed the world economy. For more than a century, Hong Kong's docks meant sweat and toil. Big ships moored at the quayside, tugs, lighters, and small junks fussed around them, pilots guided vessels in and out of the crowded waterways. Stevedores swarmed into the holds, coolies heaved loads onto trucks and handcarts, gangmasters and brokers congregated around the godowns or warehouses, each with its scarlet, smoke-wreathed shrine to Tin Hao, the goddess of the sea. With computerized cranes and smaller crews, the volume of cargo has multiplied, and only the fiercest typhoon interrupts the rhythm of commerce. The modern port of Hong Kong competes with rivals on the China coast. Hong Kong does, however, retain some advantages. Its banks, finance houses, and traders grease the wheels of business and invest its profits with unique freedom. Its courts arbitrate commercial disputes impartially, and its administrators, by and large, do not have their hand held out. In colonial days, when the thwack of cricket balls could be heard on the green, a few stolid banks and trading houses stood above the Victorian settlement radiating out along the north shore of Hong Kong Island to the Royal Yacht Club, and the noonday gun, immortalised in Noel Coward's song Mad Dogs and Englishmen. Westwards stood a grand market hall in granite and brick, surrounded by a hive of commerce. Vendors of ivory, dried fish, abalone and shark's fins, fragrant mushrooms and chests of aromatic tea, apothecaries perched amid glass cases of ginseng roots and cabinets of wizened herbs, each drawer labelled in benevolent calligraphy. All serenaded by a clamour of traffic, the calls of porters and yells and obscenities in Cantonese, the dominant tongue, and in a babel of dialects. Trams still clatter by along metal lines laid at the dawn of the 20th century, while above the old buildings tower the spires of finance and dozens of apartment blocks, which appear to defy gravity, clinging to the slopes of the peak. In the middle of Western District, imposing as a fortress, forbidding as a ziggurat, resembling a space rocket adorned by an odd sci-fi sphere at its apex, stands the liaison office of the Central People's Government. Building as statement is part of the city's spirit. The British architect Norman Foster designed a hollow metallic leviathan for the Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation, the bank branded around the world with a distinct lack of romance as HSBC. The new headquarters cost its shareholders almost $1 billion. Chinese-American wizard I.M. Pei, who grew up on the China coast, designed a glittering 1,205-foot pinnacle to house the Bank of China, HSBC's communist rival, on the site of a Victorian-era barracks for British officers. Some said the tower's soaring, sharp-angled style broke the principles of feng shui, the traditional art of geomancy employed to site buildings auspiciously, and it passed into Cantonese slang as the knife. By contrast, the staff at HSBC worked in a headquarters said to enjoy fine feng shui, because its open atrium permitted dragons to pass to and fro between the sea and the mountain. As for the third great tower in the area, the headquarters of Cheung Kong Holdings, the tycoon Li Ka-shing's conglomerate, it was designed by the celebrated architect Cesar Pelli, but its corporate rectangular lines were best described by the Greek consul, a man who knew his Doric from his Ionic, as merely the box which the Bank of China came in. More skyscrapers rise on the Kowloon Peninsula, a tongue of land named after nine dragons that juts southwards into the harbour. Until 1998, the height of buildings in Kowloon, among the world's most densely populated districts, was restricted because airliners flew low overhead on their final approach to the old Kai Tak Airport, a manoeuvre demanding icy skill as the pilot had to aim his plane at a checkerboard painted on the hillside, then veer sharp southeast to skim the rooftops and land on a single runway set in the waters of Kowloon Bay. Mistakes were rare, but the insurers sighed with relief when a new airport opened off Lantau Island and the property developers rushed in below the abandoned flight path. The richness of Kowloon endures. Its markets and temples, its streets of sleaze, carpet emporia, mosques and small electronic stores, the plaintive tailors who waylay tourists, the industrious triad gangsters, the beckoning girls and the mama sons of a dizzying selection of spas and massage joints, some of which may even be respectable. Not for Hong Kong, the hushed streets of Singapore or the mayhem of Bangkok. In normal times, its citizens' behaviour, orderly but not regimented, is a rebuke to those who claim that only authoritarian rule can avoid chaos in a crowded Chinese society. Thousands of office workers troop across intersections, obeying the pedestrian signals. In the gleaming underground railway system, the crowds keep a civilised pace, while schoolchildren and the elderly come and go without fear of being crushed. Everybody appears to pay the fare, and crime on the network is all but unknown, even when revellers go home at night. Hong Kong has its share of rude, reckless cab drivers, and only the brave, or those with no choice, ride the green and cream-coloured light minibuses that ply up and down the spiralling roads of the peak. In general, though, it is a safe and law-abiding place. Religion and traditional morality play a surprising role in a society often known for brash acquisition, pitiless business practices, and indulgence in gluttony and vice. Hong Kong ceded its reputation as the wickedest city in the Orient to other places a generation ago. The influence of Christianity is conspicuous. It may even have grown in the new era of dissent, whose rhetoric often borrows from scripture. An Anglican cathedral, ornate Roman Catholic churches, innumerable biblical prayer halls, schools, convents, hospitals, and church-run social centres and old people's homes all show the tenacity with which this imported Western religion clung to its foothold on the South China coast through a century and a half of persecution, massacres, and expulsions on the mainland. Yet Hong Kong stands for plurality, not preaching. Tolerance is embedded in its cosmopolitan heritage. Its red-hued Taoist temples, fragrant with incense and glimmering with gold, attract legions of supplicants. Buddhism infuses Chinese traditional religion. Thus, many serene images of the Buddha appear on the altars of temples alongside glowering deities and coiled dragons to soothe the majority of worshippers who feel comfortable with a blend of Buddhism, Taoism, the philosophy of Confucius, and a set of moral values resonant with a perceived Chinese identity. By himself, the Buddha is venerated among Hong Kong's Thai community in hundreds of household shrines draped in jasmine and lit by candles, presiding over rice traders, banks, restaurants, and spas. Flower-wreathed statues adorn Hindu shrines as elaborate as any in India or Nepal. On Fridays, Muslims crowd the mosques dotted around the territory, notable by their elegant green domes and modest minarets. A Jewish community of some 5,000 traces its roots to the early colonial days of Hong Kong. It boasts a fine principal synagogue dating to 1901, and its distinguished members include the Sephardic business dynasties of the Kadouris and Sassoons, while the Golden Mile of shopping on one of Kowloon's busiest roads bears the name of the Edwardian British governor and engineer who built it, Matthew Nathan. It was not just trade, but culture that flowed through the gate. Although a British colony, Hong Kong was key to the survival of Chinese art, music, opera, novel writing, filmmaking, calligraphy, pamphleteering, and journalism, all free from the censor. Its scholars preserved the intricate beauty of ancient classical ideograms after the Communist Party introduced a simpler character system in New China. For good or ill, a steady supply of antiques came out of the People's Republic, making their way to auction houses and dealers who asked few questions. It was caveat emptor for the buyer, and doubtless smugglers and fakers profited, but the alternative might have been destruction at the hands of the Maoist Red Guards in their crusade against the Four Olds, customs, culture, habits, and ideas. In that way, Hong Kong, like Taiwan, became an arc of Chinese civilization. Alongside the Chinese tradition came Western musical recitals, avant-garde theatres, and daring art shows. Hong Kongers absorbed foreign influence unbothered by the claims of party propagandists, who saw plots everywhere to subvert Chinese identity. In late colonial times, legions of serious schoolchildren in British-style uniforms soared their way through quartets or sonatas, then immersed themselves in Chinese comics on the subway home. The next generation was glued to smartphones and social media. At liberty to read and watch what they liked, Hong Kongers showed no wish to abandon their beloved Cantonese language and culture. Hong Kong did not have complete democracy, but it did have freedom. Freedom that allowed almost everything to flourish that was constrained by the state in mainland China. Profit-making, families, worship, love, knowledge, expression, experimentation, and making mistakes. For a place rooted in uncertainty, Hong Kong grew a sense of self-confidence. During the late 19th century, Hong Kong was a breach in the wall, a haven for reformers and dissidents fleeing the executioners of the Qing dynasty. A stream of South Chinese literati, political activists and students flowed through the colony as they travelled to Japan to study how another ancient Asian power was reforming and opening up to the world. Hong Kong sheltered republicans, nationalists and revolutionaries through the violent political awakening in China that led to the abdication of its last emperor in 1912. All sides used its ports, its telegraph services, its hospitals, banks and printing presses. In the 1920s, the long Chinese civil war broke out between warlords and revolutionaries. A nationalist party led by military officers, the Kuomintang, emerged from South China to become the most powerful force in the country. Then it was the turn of left-wing radicals to take refuge in Hong Kong, under the watch of the British colonial police. Japan's invasion of China in the 1930s brought a fresh influx of spies from all sides, while fugitives sought safety in the colony and proxy wars were waged in its back streets until the city fell to the Imperial Japanese Army in December 1941. At the end of the occupation, 4 years later, British colonial rule was restored, but Hong Kong had barely got back on its feet when the civil war resumed in China. The communists won in 1949, pushing a horde of defeated nationalists and refugees into the colony. It became an outpost for die-hard anti-communists, who were opposed by a small but vigorous leftist movement. Its people lived in a competitive, frenetic, and unrepentantly capitalist society. Work, accumulation, and inheritance defined their way of life. Hong Kong prospered while wars raged in Korea and Vietnam, and it grew rich as the rest of China stayed poor. Its colonial subjects were well fed while famine stalked the mainland. It was a refuge for millions of poor Chinese, a safe haven for capitalists from Shanghai, and a sanctuary for religion. Colonial rule was stable and did not threaten China, and, as we shall hear, the rulers of New China decided to leave well alone. In this time, this meant Hong Kong could be the gate through which China marched to greatness. In 1967, the ultra-left fomented riots in sympathy with the Cultural Revolution raging in China, until the political wind from the north changed and the rioting burnt out. A period of tolerance ensued, in which opponents and supporters of the communist regime published, broadcast, rallied, ran their own social services and staged political events, despite the fact that there was no democracy in Hong Kong and thus no way to run for office. Free speech also enhanced the city's value to foreign powers as a vantage point from which to study the closed society of Maoist China. When China began to open up, Hong Kong flowered. It prospered on trade, built factories, practically invented the supply chain, and pioneered outsourced manufacturing. Yet in 1989, the people of Hong Kong, long deemed apolitical and wealth-obsessed by their complacent elite, rose up in protest against the Tiananmen Square massacre in Beijing. A new activism was born. Books, magazines, pamphlets, broadcasts and faxes flowed into China. This defiance did not stop at the handover from Britain to China in 1997. At first, Hong Kong reaped unique gains as a special administrative region with a high degree of autonomy. Then China grew richer, and its Marxist leaders began to focus on the contradictions in their prize. A struggle broke out over political power, wealth, identity, data, freedom, and conformity. Successive local leaders installed by Beijing came and went, all failing to stem a tide of political activism that saw a broadly peaceful mass movement for democracy in 2014, then huge demonstrations and pitched battles against the police in 2019. The strife divided families, split the elite, and brought warnings from Beijing that black hands and hostile foreign forces were stoking a colour revolution that aimed at regime change in China. In 2020, the Chinese government imposed a national security law which led to the arrest of democratic activists, a new curriculum in schools, loyalty oaths for civil servants, and a free hand for China's security agencies to spirit people away. Some fled before they could be caught. Chinese leaders hailed it as the restoration of order, while their opponents said it was the end of liberty. The characters who populate the story of modern Hong Kong make up a vivid cast. Some are renowned. The captains and the kings, governors and tycoons, traders and moneymen, the dynasts who reared to the sky that forest of towers that glittered from afar, and the shipping magnates whose vessels plied the sea lanes. The last governor, Christopher Patton, the billionaire Li Ka-shing, the casino king Stanley Ho, the Scottish banker William Purvis, style arbiter David Tang, crusading eloquent Democrats like the barrister Martin Lee and the young champion Joshua Wong, all have won international recognition. The most influential actors, however, were rarely if ever seen publicly in Hong Kong. They were Chinese communists steeped in revolutionary secrecy and party discipline, immune to the lure of fame, careless of public approval. This book will show that time and time again, the critical decisions about Hong Kong were taken in conclave by men, and they were all men, with cruel experience of war, conspiracy, bereavement, and sacrifice. They did not hesitate to kill or to imprison, but they displayed an impressive ability to calculate for the long term. By the lights of Chinese statecraft, they did well between 1977 and 1997. They recovered Hong Kong from colonial rule, buried two treaties they had long declared unequal, and defeated the strongest British Prime Minister of the post-war era, Margaret Thatcher, who had yearned to cling on to Britain's insular possession. They did it all without firing a shot, obeying the dictum of the ancient writer Sun Tzu, who held that the finest victory was one achieved by guile alone. Some of these men were world figures. Mao Zedong, the founder of the People's Republic, his lieutenant Zhou Enlai and their heir Deng Xiaoping are all in the history books. They entrusted the party's work on Hong Kong to veteran Marxist-Leninists, whose names may come before many listeners here for the first time. One such character was Liao Chengzhi, the Japanese-speaking Comintern agent, jailed at least seven times, purged and rehabilitated, who flitted between roles in the shadows and stepped forward in his late 60s to forge a policy that worked for China and for Hong Kong, dying on the threshold of the high office that would have been his reward. Another was Li Qiang, whose bland role as a foreign trade minister in the 1970s belied a life story out of a spy novel, ranging from underground work in colonial Hong Kong to a fearless expedition to North Vietnam at the height of the American War, all due to his reputation inside the party as a technical and financial wizard. A third figure, Chi Zhengshun, deserved more attention than he has received. As the chief of Guangdong province, he talked the Communist Party leadership into the first reforms that opened up trade and investment between Guangdong and its neighbours, Hong Kong and Macau. He also merits a footnote in history as the father of Xi Jinping, a future ruler of China. The stories of all these people and many others light the path that led China from the isolated socialism of the 70s to the heights of globalization, a journey from digging ditches to managing capital flows that changed the planet. There was a Faustian bond between the prosperity of Hong Kong and the oft-proclaimed perception that since it had no ruling party, it therefore had no politics and business interests should govern it. This applied so long as Hong Kong stayed quiet and its grandees trooped up to Beijing, all smiles, to welcome the funds of the Communist Party's great families and their own opportunities to make money in the People's Republic. Neither side counted on the young, the clever, the indignant, the disadvantaged, the exploited, and the smartphone agitators of Hong Kong. They would write the next pages of its history. For a nation as great as China, Hong Kong was a tiny enclave, yet it had outsized psychological and political importance. It is sometimes forgotten that Russia and Japan took greater bites of the Qing Empire's territory than any Western power. But it was the British seizure of Hong Kong in the drawn-out conflict of the 1840s, known as the Opium Wars, and the later Anglo-French expedition which burnt down the Summer Palace in Beijing, that inflicted greatest damage on the Chinese psyche. The foreign incursions of the 19th century shattered assumptions of cultural superiority. Their effects were traumatic upon monarchists and revolutionaries alike. That is why today's battles over freedom, order, and progress in Hong Kong revive ancient fears in the capital. There is always something reactive about the presence of tiny foreign vessels in a huge body. They can act as catalysts or as agents of decay. Karl Marx said that complete isolation was the prime condition for the preservation of the old China. That isolation, having come to a violent end by the medium of England, he said, dissolution must follow as surely as that of any mummy carefully preserved in a hermetic coffin whenever it is brought into contact with the open air. Marx wrote those words about the last imperial dynasty, the Qing, but his dictum was taken to apply to any autocracy built on isolation and ritual. In recent years, many have thought that foreign influence on the Chinese state after decades of righteous seclusion would prove Marx right again, and that exposure to capitalism and liberty would hasten its decline. The men who governed China had no intention of allowing that. In less than half a century, their nation became the second largest economy in the world after the United States. Its rise was the most disruptive global transformation since the Second World War. Its continued ascent depended, they believed, on firm rule and a burning national pride, requiring the constant reminder of past weakness and shame. Xi Jinping, the communist leader who took supreme power in China after 2012, put it like this: "Only by knowing the nation's history of humiliation after the Opium War can one understand the Chinese people's strong yearning for national rejuvenation." Actually, it goes back an awful lot further than that. 1. Merchants and Mandarins. Traders from the West appeared off the coasts of China in late antiquity. Early records from the Tang Dynasty tell of a cosmopolitan throng in the city of Panyu, now known as Guangzhou, and in the West until the late 20th century as Canton. In far-off Beijing, rulers took a lofty and often benevolent view of barbarians on the fringes of their domains. The notion developed that those excluded from the celestial realm must perforce have come to it to perform rituals of tribute and obeisance. It is worth looking into this distant past. Many aspects of it resonate across more than 1,000 years of war and revolution down to modern times. It also demonstrates that the arrival of foreigners in 19th century China was neither as strange nor as unprecedented as is sometimes depicted by historians. In the Tang Dynasty, between AD 618 and 907, Guangzhou was the most prosperous of the country's southern cities. It was a frontier town, set amid wilderness populated by savages and rife with plague. Around it, though, grew plentiful lychees, oranges, bananas, and banyans. Within its triple walls lived 200,000 people. In the 9th century, some 120,000 of them were foreign merchants, according to the Arab chronicler Abu Zayd al-Sirafi. He praised China for its rule by law and admired the simplicity of its state finances, which were based on a poll tax and on the ruler's monopoly of salt and tea, whose properties, he explained, were an antidote for many ills. Abu Zayd marvelled at the Chinese genius for manufacturing. In all of God's creation, he wrote, no people were more skilled at engraving and craftsmanship. They worked in ivory and metal, jade and stone, wood and precious minerals. Not all was grace and refinement, however. Abu Zayd deplored the Chinese habit of wiping themselves after defecation instead of washing with water, while his fastidious nature recoiled at their failure to clean their hands and teeth before eating. As for the Chinese practice of having sex with their women during menstruation, their tolerance of organized prostitution, and indeed their propensity for attractive boys provided for that purpose in the temple quarters, from these Abu Zaid averted his eyes in dismay. 9th century Guangzhou throbbed with commerce. Marvellous sights awaited its visitors, and its streets bustled with strangers speaking strange tongues. One account spoke of its port jammed with the argosies of Brahmins, Persians, and Malays to a number beyond reckoning, laden with aromatics, drugs, and precious items. They brought fragrant tropical woods and much-coveted medicines to swap for bolts of silk, crates of chinaware, and slaves. China imported gum resins, sandalwood, aloes wood, camphor, patchouli, cloves, frankincense, and myrrh. Chinese businessmen gave up the comforts of the North for the profits of the South, their revenues raising the governor to such high estate that he carried 6 yak tails and possessed majesty and dignity worthy of the Son of Heaven. The administration was managed by eunuchs, one of whom was a gorgeous rascal, and graft was rife. As long as revenues flowed to the court, along with luxuries such as luminous pearls, kingfisher feathers, and the occasional live rhino, the city was left to its own manners and customs. There was a foreign quarter, where Arabs and Sinhalese mixed with white barbarians, Indian Buddhists, whose monasteries hid pools adorned with perfumed blue lotuses, and Shia Muslims from Khorasan, who had fled persecution and worshipped in their own mosque. All obeyed the summons of a drum to the great market at noon and dispersed to their own districts at the boom of the drum at sunset. The poet Chang Chi complained of the babble of barbarian voices in the night markets. While the foreign traders awaited favourable winds to set sail for home, they were ruled by a chosen worthy. They enjoyed some extraterritorial privileges, but few details of these, which would become contentious in later centuries, are known. Southern China was not a land of calm content. Rebellions broke out, thieves roamed the streets, murders were common. The captain of a Malay vessel murdered the governor, Lu Yuanjui, who had extorted money from him. In 758, a band of Arab and Persian pirates raided the city, looted its stores, burnt houses, and drove out the governor before escaping to a lair on the southern island of Hainan. For half a century afterwards, many foreign ships chose to sail to Hanoi instead of Guangzhou. Neither was the Tang period always a time of easy cosmopolitanism. Lu Chun, the governor of Guangzhou from 836, was scandalized to find foreigners and Chinese living unsegregated and even intermarrying. He put a stop to that and banned foreigners from buying houses. An imperial edict forced Turkic Uyghur Muslims, who were resented as moneylenders, to wear their distinctive costumes at all times. In the taxonomy of Chinese prejudice, Persians were rich, Malays were dark-skinned and thus ugly, Southeast Asians went naked and were immoral. Young poets ogled Iranian waitresses in wine shops, literati admired harpists and dancers from Central Asia, but the 9th century was also an age of suspicion and persecution of foreigners. Attitudes towards commerce and foreigners were ambiguous. Trade was sometimes blamed for rising prices and disorder. Some outsiders gained favour and could rise to office in the government. The new gentry class, which emerged through the introduction of an examination system, was more open-minded than the hereditary aristocracy. Some used their skills, poised between two worlds, to mediate contracts, duties, and disputes among traders and their haughty, distrustful Chinese counterparts. The privileged interlocutor was a position established more than 1,000 years before the European colonial powers set foot on the shores of Hong Kong and Macau. Even in the 9th century, the Chinese state took a commanding role in business. Aristocratic attitudes to commerce were ambiguous, and trade was never free from political entanglements. This was an age when the dynasty held monopolies on domestic goods, such as salt, iron, currency, and some basic commodities. Officials saw these as models for the control and taxation of luxuries pouring into Tang China from abroad. In the 8th century, the emperor established a commissioner for commercial argosies at Guangzhou, his duties being to buy up goods which the state wished to control and to organise their distribution. Foreigners were expected to offer some of their goods as gifts in tribute to the Son of Heaven and to demonstrate submission to his universal power. The rest of their consignments had to be deposited in government warehouses and could only be sold in the markets under official supervision. It was a rash foreign trader who would dare to sell his wares directly to the public. Then there was the vexed notion of exchange and barter. Commerce was hampered by regulations which could be imposed in the name of morals, revenue, sumptuary laws, or national security. One edict of the 8th century banned the export or sale to foreigners of tapestries, damasks, fine silk, embroidery, yak tails, pearls, gold, and iron. There was no fixed medium of exchange. Tang tombs have yielded up Byzantine gold coinage, and Arab traders at Guangzhou were said to use gold Islamic dinars to settle accounts. From time to time, officials decided that this or that foreign commodity might weaken, deprave, or corrupt the Chinese consumer. Such regulations were capricious and often temporary, but they made it hard for merchants to fix prices or make contracts. Finally, the Tang laws enshrined xenophobia. If a foreigner took a Chinese wife or concubine, a decree of AD 628 obliged him to remain in China. In no case might a Chinese woman accompany him home. If the foreign trader died in China, his goods were sealed and confiscated by the state. Like the Persian kings demanding soil and water from prostrate cities in classical Greece, the rulers of China expected symbolic acknowledgement of their supremacy from the tributary states around them. The emperors claimed that, far from threatening their august status, the arrival of foreigners not subject by birth to their graciousness tended to confirm it. This exalted attitude was to have consequences which reverberate down to modern times. At the dawn of the Age of Discovery in the 16th century, China was still remote and mysterious to Europeans. Immured behind its barriers of desert and mountain, washed by the waters of seas yet to be charted, it was a realm made for medieval romancers. The accounts of early travellers like Marco Polo, who went by land and returned by sea in the late 13th century, spoke of a great Khan, of marvels and riches, of Tartar paladins, and a summer palace called Xanadu, where wild beasts roamed amid woods and fountains. He told of a splendid port called Zaiton, for all the ships that arrive from India, laden with costly wares and precious stones of great price and big pearls, a marvel to behold. Many of the travellers' tales were fantastical. They had little authentic news about wars and politics, and what they claimed to be insight into the economy of China was little more than a simple reaction to the taxes and tribute demanded of them. Their accounts depict the manners and customs of the Chinese as strange and sinful. These foreign storytellers were free to invent and exaggerate, safe in the knowledge that the Chinese court would never read their works, and their readers were most unlikely to see China because it was so far away. Yet China was not isolated. Caravans along the Silk Road had connected the Han dynasty with the Middle East during the empires of Rome and Parthia. Chinese trading ships plied the coasts of Asia and East Africa. Under the Tang emperors, who reigned from the 7th century to the 10th, the port of Guangzhou was one of the busiest entrepôts of the world. Western religions were known in China from the same period, as a stele in a museum at Xi'an from AD 781, inscribed in Syriac and Chinese, attests. As the empire expanded, Persians and Arabs held military and administrative posts. Chinese cultural and political influence expanded to Korea and Japan. If China withdrew into seclusion while Europe flowered in the Renaissance, it was still seen from afar as a land of silks and spices, a refined civilization pursuing arts, literature, and music under an almighty ruler and his caste of mandarins. By most measures of the time, the Chinese economy was the biggest in the world. The balance of power and fortune changed in the 16th century. The kings and queens of Western Europe grew mighty and ambitious. It was the era of Henry VIII and Elizabeth I of England, François I and Henri IV of France, and Philip II of Spain. The Christian monarchies triumphed over the Ottoman Turks, who had carried the green banners of Islam to the heart of Europe. In 1529, Suleiman the Magnificent abandoned the siege of Vienna, and in 1571, an alliance defeated the Turks at the Sea Battle of Lepanto. The tide had turned, and the European nations began to look outwards. It was the start of 4 centuries of world domination by Europe, in which China was eclipsed. The growth of European power in Asia was not linear, and it was propelled by forces which no Chinese strategist of the time could have grasped. One key event was the collapse of Spanish power in continental Europe between 1640 and 1714 through foreign wars, inflation, bankruptcy, and internal strife. Here was a country which had climbed to the heights and sunk to the depths, which had achieved everything and lost everything, which had conquered the world only to be vanquished itself, wrote one historian of the Spanish Empire. Addicted to treasure from the Americas, prey to economic forces its devout monarchs did not understand, Spain still sent its galleons between Acapulco and Manila laden with silks and silver. But its part in the European adventure in Asia was at an end. The second victim of economic change was the Venetian Republic, which had grown rich on Mediterranean commerce and the overland trade with Cathay. Its decline was less steep than Spain's, but it never recovered from the voyage of the Portuguese navigator Vasco da Gama around the Cape of Good Hope in 1498. Da Gama opened a sea route to the east and destroyed the centuries-old Venetian grip on trade through the Levant. Venice, said the French philosopher Montesquieu, was thrown into a corner of the world. Today, Chinese tourists troop along the flagstones of the Rialto to Marco Polo's house, past quays where argosies laden with the silks and spices of the East once moored, where money changers dealt in bills of lading from all the known world, and a republican oligarchy built, in Shelley's words, palaces like fabrics of enchantment piled to heaven. Venice has vanished as a world power. 2 enterprising maritime nations, England and Portugal, seized the opportunity they had long sought for an all-water trade route to the Indies. In 1557, the Portuguese opened a base in Macau with the wary consent of the Chinese authorities. Their British rivals, the East India Company, began to build an empire in India and turned their eyes to China. The French and the Dutch were not far behind. All the European powers fought one another from time to time, but even if China had possessed the political skill to divide and defeat them, it was in no position to do so. In 1600, the late Ming Empire seemed to be at the peak of its splendour. The dynasty had ruled China since the 14th century. From his majestic capital in Beijing, the Son of Heaven held sway over 120 million people, more than in all the nations of Europe. There was no empire like his on earth. Mughal India was breaking up. Spanish conquistadors and foreign diseases had laid waste the Aztec and Inca empires of Mexico and Peru. The Ottomans were in retreat. Russia was a geographical expression. Japan was in the last stages of civil war before a powerful shogun of the Tokugawa clan unified it and set up his capital at Edo, modern Tokyo. In China, the imperial government was hallowed by ritual and administered by officials chosen through rigorous examinations. The wealthy enjoyed the fruits of a rich cultural and economic life, accompanied by a sense of peace and order. The late Ming period produced some of China's finest painting and some of its greatest works of literature. The Peony Pavilion, a play by the dramatist Tang Xianzu, which featured a poetic scholar official. The Journey to the West, a picaresque tale of a monk and a monkey on the road to India, and The Golden Lotus, an erotic reverie. But just as the European powers grew confident and powerful, China fell into a crisis from which, some of its intellectuals argue, it has never truly recovered. Corruption, intrigue, and decadence weakened the Ming dynasty, Floods, famines, and a brief ice age ruined farmers. Trouble in the borderlands forced tax rises to fund the military. In despair, the peasants and artisans upon whom Ming prosperity rested rose up in rebellion. Much later, some Marxists argued that Portuguese traders at Macau, that tiny foreign body in the great organism of China, were to blame because they bought up Chinese silk and traded it for silver, which was pouring out of the mines in Mexico and Peru. The resultant huge inflow of silver into China's agrarian economy led to inflation, wild speculative excess, and a boom and bust cycle, which the Confucian scholar administrators of the time were incapable of managing. In this telling, like the Spanish Habsburgs, the imperial house of China fell to forces of modernity it did not comprehend. The causes and effects of the worldwide silver crisis in the 16th century are still debated by economic historians, but it left a legacy of suspicion of foreign speculators among all subsequent rulers of China. In 1644, after a long decline, the Ming dynasty collapsed. Invading tribal armies from the northeast conquered the country and installed a dynasty of Manchu warriors. The last Ming emperor, Chongzhen, murdered his consorts, then slunk away to hang himself from a tree near the Forbidden City in Beijing. Generations of literati mourned the fall of the Ming as a cultural apocalypse. Some of the nobility scorned the Manchus. Their strange language was foreign to the dominant Han Chinese, and their customs were thought vulgar. From time to time, rebellions broke out, and tellingly, resistance lingered longest in the south. But the new dynasty, known as the Qing, won loyalty by adopting not just Han Chinese values and rituals, but the existing ruling elite. This new regime was to rule for more than 2.5 centuries. It was during the height of Qing magnificence that King George III of England sent envoys to the court of Emperor Qianlong. Chinese emperors took regnal names. Thus, Qianlong was born Aixinjoro Hongji and adopted his new name, which means perfect eminence, on acceding to the throne in 1736. Throughout his long reign, Qianlong vacillated between opening and closing the borders of the realm. Relations with barbarians were regulated by the imperial household, the Office of Border Affairs, and the Ministry of Rituals, the better to prescribe the degree of their submission. Under the Ming, the Jesuit missionary Matteo Ricci had been allowed to reside at the court in Beijing in 1601. The scholar priests translated the principles of Western mathematics, cartography, and astronomy into Chinese, and translated the works of Confucius into Western languages. Jesuits were trusted by Qianlong's grandfather, the Emperor Kangxi, to draft the Latin text of the Treaty of Nerchinsk, regulating borders and commerce between China and Russia in 1689. Trust, however, was a commodity in the shortest supply at court. By the late 18th century, foreigners were pushing at the doors of the Qing Empire in the south. To repel them, officials clung to ritual and rules, with decreasing conviction or effect. They dropped the pretense that the visitors had come to offer tribute and conceded that they might trade with the Celestial Empire at selected ports. At one of these, Guangzhou, local merchants set up a guild, known to foreigners as the Kohong, in 1720 to monopolise contacts with the traders and to control prices, fees and rake-offs. The combination of bowing to the inevitable while seeking to manage the foreigners and to profit from them became enduring Chinese policy. In 1760, an exasperated emperor ordered that all trade must be restricted to Guangzhou. The foreigners were permitted to reside there only in the trading season, which was governed by the monsoons and ran from October to March. Moreover, they could deal only with the Kohong, and might communicate only with its members in the event of disputes. Imperial officials remained in aloof seclusion, did not condescend to meet the barbarians, and often disdained to examine their petitions. To a certain cast of mind, this was meant to inspire awe, and to many Chinese it appeared magnificent. In an age when the Western powers were growing in military, economic, and diplomatic might, it was extremely unwise. During the long reign of Qianlong, the Chinese Empire appeared to foreigners to exist in a state of political and bureaucratic inertia. In fact, Chinese histories record that government by its philosopher officials was more flexible and responsive than it has been given credit for. But the ambitions of the East India Company, the pressure of Dutch seaborne commerce, the residual power of Spain, the resolute Portuguese foothold at Macau, and the first appearance of ships from the newly independent United States off the South China coast did not allow the guardians to recline and contemplate. In 1792, the British government of King George III dispatched one of its ablest diplomats, Lord Macartney, on a voyage to China. Macartney was an Irish nobleman who had toured Europe, met Voltaire, served with distinction as envoy to Catherine the Great of Russia, and completed a term as governor of Madras without scandal. His mission was to prise open the gates of the Qing Empire and to become Britain's first ambassador to the court at Beijing. The aim was to put trade on a sure footing and to compel China to enter the international state system then coming into existence. The Chinese throne had no intention of permitting any of these things to take place. The comedy of errors that ensued was recorded in Macartney's own journal and the accounts of others in his suite, becoming a feast for cartoonists back at home. Macartney was greeted with exquisite courtesy, which turned to alarm as the mandarins in attendance realised that their guest did not intend to perform the kowtow, the requirement to fall to his knees before the emperor and to prostrate himself 9 times. Travelling by canal towards the capital, his lordship became aware that the banners adorning the fleet of junks proclaimed him to be an ambassador bearing tribute to the throne. The emperor was at his pleasure dome at Chengde, known in those days as Jehol, pursuing affairs of state far from the heat and noise of Beijing. He would receive the emissaries there. Meanwhile, the English party was conducted to Beijing and given palatial quarters while they awaited word from the court and negotiated over the precise form of obeisance that would take place. Macartney adopted a principle of reciprocity that would bedevil encounters between China and the West forever after, maintaining that he would pay the same respect to the emperor as he would to his own monarch. The negotiations became fraught. Meanwhile, presents from George III, including crystal chandeliers, Derbyshire porcelain, a globe, clocks, a barometer and an orrery, a clockwork model of the solar system, were arranged in the summer palace known as the Yuanming Yuan, the Gardens of Perfect Brightness, for Qianlong to inspect on his return. Many came to gape, but some professed indifference. One courtier was at pains to emphasise that the items were not gifts, but tribute. The awkward diplomatic interlude was resolved by a summons from Chengde, announcing that the emperor, in his graciousness, would receive Lord Macartney, and that the customary protocol would be eased in recognition of the great distance he had travelled and the presents he had brought. It appeared to be a victory for British prestige. It was also a foretaste of misunderstandings and disappointments to come. Macartney and his suite traversed the Great Wall and reached Chengde in mid-September 1793. At the appointed time, mandarins led him to his place. He had donned his velvet robes of the Order of the Bath and fastened his diamond decorations. As the emperor swept by in his palanquin, Lord Macartney fell on one knee and bowed, as did all the British present, while the Chinese prostrated themselves in the dust. Qianlong ascended the throne, and the peer knelt before him to present a bejewelled box containing a letter from King George III, receiving in return a jade sceptre. At the banquet which followed, the emperor, who was 83, inquired after the English sovereign's age and health. It was becoming clear to the ambassador that neither Qianlong nor his ministers had a very clear idea of exactly where England was, or knew much about it. They had, however, heard with horror about the French Revolution, and had no intention of allowing pernicious doctrines, such as the rights of man, to take root in the celestial kingdom. While Macartney lingered at Chengde, he met the most influential member of the imperial retinue, the principal minister named Hershen. As a young Manchu guards officer, Hershen had caught the ageing emperor's eye. He became Qianlong's favourite and had risen to high and lucrative rank through diligence, guile and charm. If Lord Macartney was aware of the scandalous rumours around Hershen's unparalleled ascent, he did not dignify them with comment, recalling his interlocutor as a handsome and fluent man. The two went riding around the Imperial Gardens and Parkland, exchanging pleasantries which served to probe each other's true intentions, as practised diplomats do. In his journal, Macartney noted that Hershen's suspicions were aroused by the fact that the English were both infinitely curious about China and yet well informed about its history. It was an encounter which foreshadowed others in the centuries ahead between intrusive foreign envoys and wary Chinese office holders. Both the Manchu court and its barbarian visitors maintained a veneer of courtesy to the end of the Macartney mission. The ambassador met Qianlong several times. The emperor deigned to inspect the gifts laid out in the Palace of the Gardens of Perfect Brightness, and for a while, Lord Macartney was tempted to believe he might be permitted to remain in China. He was soon disabused of the notion. A date was fixed for his departure, and in reply to the letter from King George III, the envoy received an edict from Qianlong, which, even at a distance of more than two centuries, resounds with doomed magnificence. The British had asked China to liberalise the trading system at Guangzhou, to open up more ports for commerce, to fix tariffs in line with international practice, and to allow an ambassador to reside at Beijing. For Qianlong and his ministers, these were impossible demands. In his response, the emperor acknowledged the tribute proffered by George III, but pointed out that China had never valued ingenious articles and did not have the slightest need of your country's manufactures. As for the request to station an ambassador at Beijing, apart from not being in harmony with the regulations of the Celestial Empire, this would be of no advantage to your country. Therefore, the tribute envoys had been commanded to return home, while their monarch was enjoined simply to act in conformity with our wishes by strengthening your loyalty and swearing perpetual obedience so as to ensure your country may share the blessings of peace. The edict had been drawn up before Macartney's disembarkation at the Gulf of Bohai months earlier. His expedition cost the East India Company £78,000, for which it got nothing, although the peer himself cleared a handy £20,000 profit. It was a failure. On his way home, Macartney wrote down a famous set of impressions which have influenced generations of Western diplomats until the present day. The Empire of China is an old, crazy, first-rate man of war, which a fortunate succession of able and vigilant officers has contrived to keep afloat for these 150 years, and to overawe their neighbours merely by her bulk and appearance, he judged. But it would drift and be dashed to pieces on the shore when officered by less competent rulers. History was on the side of progress, and the Qing, he believed, were conducting a vain attempt to arrest the progress of human knowledge. For China, resistance to modernity was futile. In 1816, the British government dispatched a second embassy under Lord Amherst to seek a trade agreement. It too was repulsed after the British envoy declined to perform the kowtow to Qianlong's successor, the Emperor Jia Qing. Serene and impassive, the Chinese ship of state sailed on. But things were changing fast inside and outside China. Among the first casualties of the new reign was the astute, if over-covetous, Hershen, who was brought down by his rivals for corruption and was graciously permitted to strangle himself with a silken cord presented on a cushion. The new emperor seized Hershen's palaces, his golden treasure and his cache of precious stones, fortifying his own authority by a relentless fixation on ceremonial and sumptuary rules. In this way, the dynasty exchanged a perverse but effective ruling partnership between Qianlong and his principal minister for a hollow crown, one preoccupied by overmighty vassals and deaf to counsel. There could not have been a less auspicious time for China to retreat into empty absolutism. Beyond China's shores, trade and finance were making the modern world. The first American vessel to sail for Guangzhou, the Empress of China, left in 1784 laden with silver currency and 30 tons of ginseng root from the woods of New England, returning to New York the next year carrying teas and silks. In the following decades, traders from the United States crossed the Pacific with goods sought by the Chinese, sandalwood from Hawaii, furs from Alaska, and bêche de mer, or sea slugs, which were dried and packed in Fiji. The port of Salem, Massachusetts, grew wealthy on trade funded by consortiums of investors who pooled their money to finance the early voyages to China. A man could get in on it for as little as $100. The average was $4,000. The biggest investor in one consignment of 1819 paid $100,000. The ships went out with barrels of silver Spanish dollars, raw cotton, pigs of lead and kegs of quicksilver, in addition to ginseng and other commodities. They came back with porcelain, tea, silk, lacquer, tortoiseshell combs and toys. Wives, children and friends made detailed requests for goods to be bought on their behalf in Guangzhou. A sophisticated system evolved in Salem to run the business. Shipbuilding, dockworks, finance, accountancy and law, crewing, victualling and navigation. The United States was in the Pacific trade and would never look back. On the far side of the world, commerce between British India and the China coast grew rapidly as the British expanded their possessions and British merchants looked for opportunities and growth. The Napoleonic Wars distracted the attention of the government in London, but after 1815, Britain's forward march resumed in Asia. France ceased to be a serious rival in the East after Waterloo. The Portuguese were reduced to their foothold at Macau. As for the Dutch, with whom Britain had fought wars and traded colonial possessions, their golden age was over. The Anglo-Dutch Treaty of 1824 made the British dominant from India to the South China Sea and confined the Dutch to the East Indies. A small trading post named Singapore, founded in 1819 and ruled by Britain, marked the boundary between their spheres of influence. So, by a combination of developments which were all but unknown to the rulers of China, a small island chain on the far side of the world had become their most powerful adversary, less than 3 decades after Lord Macartney had been sent on his way. All the European maritime powers dispatched cargo ships to China, but British naval power, military skill and financial resources made London the arbiter of events. A steadily increasing volume of trade flowed up and down the Pearl River Delta. Chinese exports of tea, silk and porcelain were carried to the new consumers of Europe, a continent at peace and poised on the threshold of prosperity. Even in its high and palmy years, the Qing dynasty's own ordinances unwittingly increased British influence. The value of Chinese exports through Guangzhou in the first decades of the 19th century was more than double that of China's imports. The balance was paid by the foreigners in silver currency. At first, the East India Company had to ship silver to Guangzhou by the barrel. Then it turned out that merchants in Guangzhou were sitting on piles of silver because the Chinese government forbade them to export their cash profits. So they handed over their silver to the East India Company, whose financial wizards issued bills of exchange, which could be redeemed in London or Calcutta. The company's buyers then used the silver at Guangzhou to buy shipments of tea for the thirsty British market, thus at a stroke removing the risk of shipping specie and increasing the growth of London as a global centre of finance. At the same time, the immense sums of money handed over in duties and fees threw off rich opportunities for official venality and generated a stream of revenue for the imperial coffers. This helped the Qing pay for the military expenditure needed to hold down a tide of rebellions and disorder across China. The money was addictive. The dynasty could not have stopped commerce, even if it had wanted to. Eventually, this system succumbed to 4 fatal afflictions. The plague of official corruption became a drag on the functioning of Chinese government. In 1833, Parliament in London ended the East India Company's monopoly on trade, throwing open the marketplace and creating a free-for-all. the Anglo-Chinese monopolists, the East India Company and the Kohong merchants of Guangzhou, henceforth faced intense competition from new houses founded in Calcutta and Bombay, which offered lower interest rates and plunged into commodities through destabilizing cycles of boom and bust. The final blow, however, came through the ceaseless and apparently unstoppable growth of investment and trade in what has been called the third great Indian export crop after indigo and cotton. This was opium. The trade in opium and the connected Anglo-Chinese wars dominated relations between China and the West in the 19th century and inflicted a wound on the Chinese psyche that has yet to heal. To Marxists and to non-ideological Chinese patriots alike, they remain the epitome of imperialist crime. For economic historians, they provide a textbook study of the interplay between commerce and state power, set in a distant time when nations behaved towards each other in ways unrestrained by the corpus of modern international law, and when most societies were organized in ways that would be unacceptable today. Opium was not introduced to China by the British. It had been used in the empire since the Tang Dynasty. The first opium-yielding poppies may have come to China with Arabs and Turkish traders. The drug's medicinal properties were listed in the Chinese pharmacopoeia perhaps as early as the 5th century, and its addictive character was understood. For around a millennium, it was eaten unprocessed as a medicine. But in the 17th century, users on the island of Formosa, modern Taiwan, began to mix it with tobacco and smoke it. During this period, Dutch and Spanish colonizers vied with Chinese armies for control of Taiwan. There was frequent intercourse with the mainland, and the opium smoking habit spread. China produced a small quantity of opium, but most of its supply came from India, a low-grade variety named Malwa that was shipped by the Portuguese through Macau. In 1729, the Qing rulers banned the import of opium. Mandarins fretted over its bad effects on society, although the drug continued to flow into China through greased palms. In 1773, the East India Company decided to compete against the Portuguese by paying farmers in Bengal to grow high-quality Patna opium. The company knew that its business was illicit. In 1796, it abandoned direct exports to China. Instead, the drug was sold to private merchants at auction in Calcutta. The chests were still shipped in company vessels, but the opium itself was peddled to the Chinese by others, saving face all round. Between 1800 and 1818, the trade was stable at an estimated total of about 4,000 chests, weighing £140 each. From 1819, however, prices fell due to intense competition between British and Portuguese traders, and the opium trade boomed. The dynasty ordered a crackdown in Guangzhou. The foreign traders simply moved their contraband stocks to floating hulks off Lintin Island in the Pearl River Delta. Chinese wholesalers bought the opium. Rugged tanker rivermen carried it upstream in 40-oared boats, known as fast crabs. Imperial functionaries pocketed bribes, and Chinese gangsters and triad secret societies distributed the drug inland. Between 1822 and 1830, the trade grew to an estimated 18,760 cases a year. The East India Company recorded that £4 million was sent back to England in 1830. Most of it was converted into opium to be sold in Guangzhou, the revenues being invested in teas for export to England, on which the British government reaped a further £3.3 million in tariffs. Investment in opium, private profits, and government revenues from the trade became a central element of British policy in Asia. China found its balance of payments going into reverse. In the first decades of the 19th century, it had earned a surplus, but after 1820 it went into deficit. The historian Frederick Wakeman, writing in the 1970s, concluded that it was opium which shifted the balance and ended up financing much of the later colonization of India. So compelling was the commercial logic that the East India Company took over shipments of Portuguese Malwa opium through Calcutta in 1831. 5 years later, opium imports into China were valued at 18 million silver dollars. In volume, the trade surged to 30,000 cases in 1835 and 40,000 in 1838. This was, Wakeman wrote, the world's most valuable single commodity trade of the 19th century. Inside China, the growth of addiction and the little understood effects of the outflow of silver currency caused perplexity and anguish. The Emperor Daoguang deplored the drug's impact on morality and urged the Mandarinate to manifest virtue, but the lure of easy riches had corroded his administration. Huge swings in market forces began to disrupt the order of Qing society. Peasants earned their pittance in copper cash, but their land taxes were calculated and remitted to the government in silver. By 1838, the number of copper coins needed to buy one silver tael had risen from 1,000 to 1,650. By 1842, it had risen to more than 2,000. The tael, an ingot of silver, varied in weight by region, but was usually about 37 grams, or 1.3 ounces. The real rate of taxation doubled, ruining many. The most populous and heavily taxed regions of China south of the Yangtze became turbulent. Poverty, discord, and rural rebellions multiplied. In the Communist Party's historical view, misery begat addiction, and both were fueled by foreign poison. In the mid-19th century, there were about 450 million people in China. Few reliable estimates exist of how many used opium, but their number grew fast. A study by Professor Jonathan Spence of Yale University calculated that by the 1880s, the number of smokers may have reached 10% of the population. In response, Daoguang initiated a debate between legalizers and moralists to determine how the government could manage the crisis. The legalizers argued that prohibition was futile, enforcement merely led to corruption, and it would be better for the dynasty to permit and regulate opium consumption, thereby earning revenues from it. The moralists held that obedience to the law was the foundation of the Confucian order, and that China might strengthen the throne and achieve moral rebirth by adhering to it. The emperor's own instincts lay with austerity and control. Perhaps he did not know that officials in the south sent him false reports of natural disasters in order to secure tax remissions, rather than admit or explain the desperate straits to which small landowners were reduced by silver inflation and their fiscal burden. It would not be the last time that rulers in Beijing were badly informed about their distant provinces. In any case, the emperor was vexed by complications. It was plain to him that foreign mud was a curse, but it was not simple to eradicate it. The economics were inconclusive, and given the standards of data available in 19th century China, its rulers can be forgiven for being fuddled. Critics of imperialism, however, saw in the opium trade a classic example of exploitation. Marx argued in the 1850s that the Western powers depended on the drug traffic to offset their imports from China and were addicted to its revenues for their own expenditure. It followed that the huge outflow of silver currency from China was draining its economy and pushing up the domestic price of the silver tael, causing rural misery in China while cushioning the rentiers of Europe. It was not as simple as that. The silver price in China was also affected by a worldwide shortage of the metal. Within the empire, silver soared in value after Qing officials debased the copper currency by minting cheaper coins in response to falling production at the copper mines in Yunnan province. This amounted to devaluation and to a surge in the circulation of copper cash. Gresham's law, which states that bad money drives out good, came into operation, and silver became so sought after that it grew scarce. A final complication was that calculations of the flow of silver were distorted by the fact that some of it never physically left China, because Western brokers in opium and tea at Guangzhou settled their accounts by bills exchanged in London. Weighing the arguments on both sides of the debate, Daoguang decided to back the moralists. Sweeping aside complexity, the emperor saw a narcotic not only corrupting his subjects, but also introducing uncontrollable financial volatility and insulting barbarian encroachment on the celestial empire, which he believed could certainly be repulsed. China and Britain almost came to blows in 1834, when Lord Napier, appointed as the first superintendent of the China trade, tried to break with precedent by announcing himself in a formal letter to the governor of Guangzhou, instead of abiding by the regulations, which forbade direct contact between Chinese officials and foreigners. The governor ordered Napier to leave, and when he refused, sent a fleet of war junks to block the Royal Navy from coming to his aid. Trade halted. Broken by malaria and let down by the merchants, who feared for their businesses, Napier retreated to Macau, where he died. The Chinese and the British drew diametrically opposed conclusions from the Napier fiasco. In Beijing, the emperor read the exultant memorials from his officials and felt the barbarians could be held hostage with ease to compel their obedience. In London, the government realized it was rash to challenge the Qing dynasty without having sufficient force at its disposal to fight a war. It was in the interests of both sides for trade to continue, but this tragicomic misunderstanding meant that the period of calm was only a truce. Britain and China did not declare war, they drifted into it. In 1838, Dao Guang appointed Lin Zexu, a stern scholar administrator of incorruptible rectitude, to exterminate the opium trade in Guangzhou. Today, Lin is a national hero, memorialized in statues, in which he invariably looks severe and dignified in his robes of office in the cities of the south. Lin won the emperor over with a memorial grounded in Confucian philosophy, arguing for a campaign against traffickers that would be tempered by the enlightened treatment of addicts and the sparing use of executions. The outcome of his efforts, however, was a disaster for China. Upon Lin's arrival in Guangzhou as imperial commissioner, the tempo quickened. He ordered local officials and the gentry to act against smugglers and dealers, relying on traditional methods of surveillance and psychological coercion to persuade the smokers themselves to abstain. Investigations, arrests, and seizures of opium began across the region. Lin wrote a letter of advice to Queen Victoria in stylized court language, informing her that the emperor was in a towering rage and deploring the arrival of barbarians selling a poisonous drug in China, which, he had heard, is very strictly forbidden by your country. This was an error. In fact, opium was not prohibited in Victorian England, where it was the aspirin and benzodiazepine of its day, consumed by all classes as pills and taken as a liquid in the form of laudanum, a tincture laced with alcohol. Its literary adherents included the poet Samuel Taylor Coleridge, who wrote his celebrated verses on Kublai Khan in a trance, and Mary Shelley's character Victor Frankenstein, who used laudanum to numb himself asleep. Once again, Anglo-Chinese incomprehension was mutual and complete. Lin told the Chinese merchants in Guangzhou that the foreigners must hand over their opium stocks without compensation and sign bonds promising never to deal in the drug again. The traders agreed to surrender a token quantity of 1,056 chests. Unconvinced, Commissioner Lin seized two Chinese hostages and ordered the arrest of Lancelot Dent, head of the second largest foreign firm and president of the British Chamber of Commerce. Thousands of Chinese troops surrounded the riverside enclave where the foreigners lived and had their factories, compounds which housed accommodation, offices and warehouses known as godowns. The alarm was sent to Captain Charles Elliot, the British superintendent of trade, who was at Macau. Elliot, a former naval officer, had been appointed by Lord Palmerston, the Foreign Secretary, who wanted to pursue a more robust policy towards China. Palmerston was a member of the Whigs, a political party which combined reforming zeal and a belief in the supremacy of Parliament at home with dedication to free trade and the expansion of British power abroad. The principal opium merchants, partners William Jardine and James Matheson, had his ear. Palmerston had an acute sense of what the public expected of its ministers in upholding British prestige. He also understood that, to the Chinese, protocol was the essence of the tribute system and forbade Eliot to submit to it. Palmerston was not alone in his view. During this time of imperial expansion, it was unthinkable that the subjects of Queen Victoria should be subject to arbitrary prosecution by a foreign power. An Englishman could expect the protection of his own government, whether or not he was an opium trader like Dent, and no minister could agree that Englishmen must sign bonds acknowledging the jurisdiction of the Emperor of China and submitting to trial and decapitation if they broke those bonds. The principle became known as extraterritoriality, and it was to vex relations between foreign powers and China until the Communist Revolution of 1949 put an end to it. For Palmerston, as for Eliot, it was a principle which created the conditions for war. For the first time, the Chinese were dealing with a representative of the British Crown, not an employee of the East India Company. If that distinction was lost on Commissioner Lin, it was clear to Eliot. He did not have absolute powers, but he had authority to call on his old service, the Royal Navy, and on British forces stationed in India. Eliot arrived in Guangzhou to find himself blockaded with his compatriots. Facing the same dilemma as Lord Napier, he capitulated. The traders agreed to hand over 20,000 chests of opium, and almost all were allowed to leave for Macau. To the rage of Lord Palmerston, Eliot undertook that the British government would compensate them for their loss. Cynics noted that the traders, stuck with a surplus of opium due to Commissioner Lin's campaign, must have gratefully received the government's generosity and had inflated their stocks. But that was a British problem. Commissioner Lin wrote a triumphant memorial to the throne. He supervised the destruction of almost £3 million of raw opium by hundreds of labourers, who mixed it with water, salt and lime in trenches, then flushed it into the river and out to the ocean, while the commissioner prayed to the spirit of the southern seas to bless his purifying deed. Having expelled the British from Guangzhou, Lin found that American merchants were willing to sign his bonds and step profitably into the breach as middlemen in the legal trade in tea and silks. Obedient to the law of unintended consequences, the commissioner pursued his quarry to Macau, intent on stamping out British impudence for good. Lin's resolve hardened after a Chinese farmer named Lin Wei-si was killed in a brawl with British sailors. Eliot, while paying compensation, refused to hand anyone over to imperial justice. It was the principle of extraterritoriality again. Lin ordered war junks to blockade the Portuguese enclave, while his soldiers mustered on its fringes. Portuguese morale crumbled swiftly, and the British were told to leave. On the 24th of August, 1839, Captain Eliot and his companions boarded their ships and sailed across the Gulf to anchor near the best deep-water bay on the southern coast at Hong Kong, the Fragrant Harbour. In London, where William Jardine had returned in wrath, the government put its faith in gunboat diplomacy. Advised by Jardine and his fellow lobbyists, Lord Palmerston drew up a list of formidable demands for China. Britain prepared a fleet commanded by Captain Eliot's cousin, Admiral George Eliot, of 16 warships, 4 armoured steamers and troop transports. They carried an army of 4,000, equipped with artillery and rapid-firing guns. Speaking in the House of Commons for the Whig cabinet in the debate of the 7th of April, 1840, Thomas Babington Macaulay said Britons on the China coast belonged to a country unaccustomed to defeat, to submission or to shame. A country which has exacted such reparation for the wrongs to her children as has made the ears of all who heard it to tingle. In response, the young William Gladstone, at that time a Tory, uttered words which are known in China to this day. A war more unjust in its origin, a war more calculated to cover this country in permanent disgrace, I do not know and I have not read of, he said, adding that the British flag was hoisted on the coast of China to protect an infamous contraband traffic. The war, when it came, was drawn out but decisive. Between 1840 and 1842, the British won a series of victories. The fleet forced its way up the Pearl River, bombarded Guangzhou, and imposed a blockade of the city. British ships sailed north to threaten the Zhoushan Islands, off the port of Ningbo. A broadside from HMS Wellesley put the inhabitants of Zhoushan to flight. British soldiers landed and raised their flag. An early British visitor, Sir George Staunton, had compared the charms of Zhoushan's harbour to those of Venice. Whoever possessed the small archipelago commanded the approaches to the Yangtze, the mightiest river in China. At first, the British aggression created shock at the Emperor's Grand Council. This turned to fear as the fleet sailed on northwards to the forts guarding the High River, the water route to Beijing itself. Daoguang did what Chinese rulers have often done when facing failure. He replaced the official on the spot. Commissioner Lin, who had prided himself on awing the barbarians into submission, was dismissed and exiled to the wintry borderlands with Russia. A rich and sophisticated Manchu governor, Qi Shan, took over. He began negotiations with Charles Elliot. The English warships sailed south again while the envoys talked. Britain was demanding the cession of Hong Kong, a huge indemnity, direct contact with the throne, and trade on British terms. In short, a manifesto to force open the old China and shatter its value system. For all his political skills, Qi Shan found himself in a plight that would be replicated in centuries to come by Chinese negotiators with the West. Confronted by a powerful opponent, assailed by conservatives at court, suspected by his emperor of being an appeaser, he miscalculated. Qi Shan appreciated that the handover of Chinese territory was the worst outcome and felt the English might trade Hong Kong for more money and new ports. But time was not on his side. The British resumed military action and instructions from Beijing took weeks to arrive. On the 20th of January 1841, the two envoys agreed the Convention of Chuenbi, which conceded the British demands and fixed an indemnity of 6 million silver dollars. 6 days later, Elliot proclaimed British sovereignty over Hong Kong, although he had no authority to do so. In return, Britain was to hand back Zhoushan. Few agreements have been so swiftly and unanimously disowned by their principals. The emperor, aghast, dismissed Qi Shan and ordered his execution, a sentence later commuted to the confiscation of his wealth. He left Guangzhou in chains. The ire in London, though less draconian in its consequences, was compounded by surprise. Lord Palmerston could not understand why Elliot had traded Zhoushan for the barren island of Hong Kong. The 22-year-old Queen Victoria called Elliot's conduct unaccountably strange and said he completely disobeyed his instructions and tried to get the lowest terms he could. For his part, Elliot was the first, but not the last, British negotiator with China to face similar accusations. A new envoy, the Anglo-Irish soldier and diplomat Sir Henry Pottinger, was appointed, and Britain went to war with China again. Pottinger arrived from India in August 1841 with a new spirit of initiative. He refused to treat with a minor Chinese envoy, stiffened the backbone of the merchants, inspected the new building works at Hong Kong, rallied his soldiers, and ordered the naval commanders to make ready, disdaining two severe typhoons. His amphibious campaign was daring and swift. The British captured Xiamen and Ningbo, retook the island of Zhoushan, and launched an offensive in May 1842 to cut China's inland waterways, aiming to force a rapid surrender. The war was shocking and psychologically transformative. At Ningbo, the gates were opened after British naval guns destroyed its nearby fortress. Pottinger ordered his men to remove, carry away, or destroy public property, in which I include whatever belonged to the emperor or his officers, and the official residences of the authorities, the granaries, timber yards, war junks, and boats. I would carry this work of destruction of whatever buildings may be public to the extremest point, burning any furniture or other articles found in them that may not be worth or be too heavy or cumbersome for removal. It was, he said, an act of retribution for the ill treatment of Britons, that would serve as an example and warning to other places. Pottinger had been outraged to hear that survivors of a shipwreck, including the master's widow and two boys, had been manacled, put into bamboo cages, and paraded to Ningbo amid the hootings and howlings of the assembled savages. The Chinese squandered their counterattack at Ningbo by sending tribal levies from Sichuan province, armed only with long knives, to charge into the teeth of British grapeshot and landmines, while panicky raw recruits piled in behind them and were cut down in hundreds until blood ran in the streets. The slaughter repelled even those inflicting it. Such scenes were repeated on battlefields along the coast. Cruelty was the currency of war, but the British found that in China they had discovered refinements to it, which began to harden the hearts of Pottinger and his commanders. The body of a British private was found mutilated with his own razor, which had been used to cut off his ears and nose and to cut out his eyes, prompting an officer to reflect of the perpetrators that it was great proof of their ferocity amidst the horrors of their own situation, expecting almost immediate death. At Junjiang, the Manchu garrison of 1,600 bannermen killed themselves rather than surrender, first cutting the throats of their wives to spare them from rape and murdering their own children. Contemporary British accounts told of soldiers treading amid heaps of Chinese bodies, swollen and blackened from poison, while corpses hung from roof beams and floated in shallow wells. Pottinger's biography noted that he stored up these things in his mind, and realised that he was dealing with a callous culture of a kind not previously experienced. The shock was many textured. On the Chinese side, the suicidal loyalty of the Manchu clansmen was offset by a creeping suspicion that the dynasty could not count on its own Han Chinese subjects in its fight to survive. Rogues from the Pearl River Delta followed the British army to plunder and burn Chinese homes. The opium trade had created a nexus between the Westerners and all those criminals, secret societies, and small merchants in the southern coastal cities who chafed against the hand of authority. Rumours of treachery spread among Manchu commanders, who saw spies everywhere among river junk captains, salt smugglers, and rural bandits. Before the self-slaughter at Junjiang, the Manchu soldiers had turned on the local people in a reign of terror, murdering any who were thought to be suspicious. Political as well as military considerations, therefore, compelled Dao Guang to come to terms with the invaders. The seizure of Hong Kong was a decisive loss, and defeat in the First Opium War marked the beginning of the end for imperial rule in China. Western technology had won against raw bravery, and the well-drilled British military confounded traditional Chinese generalship. The war did not overthrow the Qing system, but ultimately it eroded the Manchu dynasty's faith in itself and destroyed its people's confidence in it. After 1842, the Chinese ruling order was in retreat until, according to communist histories at least, Mao Zedong founded New China in 1949. China was unlucky too in the political timing. In the summer of 1842, Britain needed a feat of arms to restore confidence in its own ruling elite after a catastrophic defeat in Afghanistan. During the retreat from Kabul in the winter of 1841-42, an entire army was lost, one of Pottinger's own nephews was killed, and another was wounded and taken hostage. This was a period in British political life of reaction versus reform, of a contest between the aristocracy and the rising new classes, and of a bold new debate over whether the right to govern was due to merit or to birth, a tantalising comparison for those who knew of it with the meritocratic elite chosen by examinations to serve the Chinese state, even if the emperor's Manchu clansmen held its great offices and commands. In the latter stages of the war, Britain entrusted its ambitions in the field to the hereditary aristocracy. Lord Elgin, a brace of knights, and an admirable of distinguished lineage, all of whom did their duty well, and in some cases heroically, while its diplomats on the China coast served foreign secretaries who included a duke, a viscount, and five earls. It is almost impossible to picture the deference, the adulation, the extraordinary privileges according to the nobility in the first half of the 19th century, a British historian of the period wrote. In 1842, the Duke of Wellington himself returned as Commander-in-Chief for life of the British Army at the age of 73, unflinching in his view that the army was not to be dictated to by the House of Commons. Yet Britain's adventure in China also advanced a new elite. It created entrepreneurs who made fortunes, and it promoted administrators like John Bowring, a liberal polymath who was knighted only when he became the fourth governor of Hong Kong, and Harry Parkes, a brash linguist and diplomat, a typical example of the self-confident go-getter of modest background who seized the opportunities afforded by the empire. Notably, many of the men who governed the empire in the East or who prospered in it were Scottish or Irish. There was more at stake for British policy in China than a barren rock and profits from opium. It was also about power and control. The British army in China was led by gentlemen who purchased their commissions, a system upheld by Wellington, who felt it kept a connection between the army and the higher classes of society, avoiding the emergence of the type of professionally officered armies which had led to military despotism in Europe. Military prowess safeguarded British commerce and extended Queen Victoria's realms. It was not to be interfered with by elected politicians. A successful punitive expedition in Afghanistan and victory over the Chinese Empire vindicated this opinion. The Treaty of Nanjing, which sealed the British victory, was signed on the 29th of August 1842 on board HMS Cornwallis by Pottinger and three Chinese representatives, Qi Ying, Ili Bu and Niu Jian. The documents were bound in silk. Each of the Qing emissaries imprinted them with a great red rectangular seal and inscribed the required assent in fine calligraphy. Sir Henry scrawled his signature across the page. During the exchange of courtesies, Qi Ying fed Pottinger several sugar plums directly into his mouth, saying this was an old custom. Plums aside, there was nothing to sweeten the bitterness of the Treaty of Nanjing for China. It has been called the most important treaty settlement in China's modern history. It handed the island of Hong Kong to Queen Victoria and her successors in perpetuity, opened five treaty ports to foreign merchants, abolished the Kohong merchant monopoly, imposed an indemnity of 21 million silver dollars on China to be paid in instalments, set unspecified moderate tariffs on trade, and formally buried the grandiose language of subservience with an agreement that henceforth the countries would address each other as equals. The agreement was seen by patriots as the first unequal treaty between China and a foreign power. But all treaties are unequal, for if a perfect balance existed between states, no diplomatic agreements would be needed to keep the peace between the weak and the strong. The first concessionary treaty of the Qing dynasty had been made on China's Muslim frontier in 1835 with the Khan of Khokan, a predatory neighbour who dominated the trade routes to Central Asia. It conceded a swathe of demands to the Khan, even allowing his consular representatives in China's far west to try cases and levy taxes on foreigners, the principle of extraterritoriality which caused such conflict with the Western powers. The trade concessions were similar to those granted to Russia at its solitary permitted trading post in northeast China. Appeasement, therefore, had been a tool for the Qing Empire in the past. Mandarins like Qi Ying argued that it would work against the barbarians. The trouble was that it did not. China had been wrenched open by the British, but other nations soon followed them. In 1843, President John Tyler sent a Massachusetts congressman, Caleb Cushing, to negotiate trading privileges with Qi Ying. The treaty they signed allowed Protestant missionaries access to China, abolished attempts to prevent foreigners learning the Chinese language, and conceded extraterritorial powers to American consuls. The French came afterwards with an even more exacting treaty, which compelled the emperor to issue an edict of toleration for Roman Catholics, abolishing a ban on missionaries instituted by his ancestors. As for the British, they could afford to build up their new possession at Hong Kong, while others increased pressure on the Qing, for under a most favoured nation clause attached to their own treaty, they would receive the same benefits as those won by any rival power. This remarkably inept diplomatic bargain by Qi Ying robbed the dynasty of any chance to play the barbarians off against each other. Despite this raft of concessions, which many Chinese saw as the start of 100 years of humiliation, the foreigners were not satisfied. Qi Ying had persuaded the throne that the devil was in the details and that China would wear down the intruders by patience, rules and formality. During the 1840s, the dynasty recovered its poise and foreign traders grew disappointed with their lot, even as Jardine Matheson sent a fleet of 80 clippers to run the opium trade, which grew to 60,000 chests a year. At court, the view that China possessed a superior civilization had not yet been shattered. But at the end of the decade, a millenarian revolt broke out in eastern Guangxi province, inland from Hong Kong. It was led by a charismatic rabble-rouser, Hong Xiuquan, who declared himself to be the younger brother of Jesus Christ and proclaimed a heavenly kingdom of great peace. The Taiping Rebellion against the Manchu demons consumed the reign of the Emperor Xianfeng, who succeeded Dao Guang in 1850. And while its Christian origins initially attracted Western sympathy, the foreign powers soon perceived it as a threat, helped to finance and organise the Qing armies that put it down, then gazed on while some 20 million Chinese lives were lost. In 1854, the British took advantage of the chaos to press for renegotiation of the Treaty of Nanjing, demanding commercial access to all of the Chinese interior and legalisation of the opium trade. The return of Lord Palmerston as Prime Minister licensed the boldest councils, while the xenophobic Qing governor at Guangzhou, Ye Mingchen, was haughty, provocative and indifferent, inciting the public to hatred of the barbarians, while apparently unaware of the change in British policy which would lead to his defeat and death in exile. The governor of Hong Kong, the newly knighted Sir John Bowring, found the casus belli he sought in 1856, when Ye's bravos boarded the Arrow, a lorcha, or sailing vessel rigged Chinese style, that was owned by a Chinese, Fong Aming, had been registered in Hong Kong and was nominally captained by Thomas Kennedy from Belfast. Its registration papers had expired, but Bowring and his consul Harry Parkes brushed that detail aside. Rear Admiral Sir Michael Seymour sailed his fleet up the Pearl River, seized the forts guarding the approaches to Guangzhou and bombarded the city. Ye remained immovable, trade halted and a row broke out in Parliament in London. A year later the British returned in force, joined by the French, and after a delay in the arrival of reinforcements due to the Indian mutiny. This time Guangzhou fell. The Allies installed a joint commission to rule the city, exiled Ye to India, and appointed a puppet Chinese governor in his place. An expedition commanded by Lord Elgin then headed north to threaten the port of Tianjin and the capital itself. This set off a battle between diehards and appeasers at the court of the ineffective young emperor. Caution prevailed. The dynasty capitulated and signed the Treaty of Tianjin, whose provisions were the harshest yet. Opium was to be taxed and regulated, more cities were opened up to commerce, foreign trade was permitted deep in the interior, Christian missionaries could evangelize, and ambassadors would reside at Beijing. As a final touch, the Chinese character for barbarian was banned from documents. All this was shame enough, but the bitterest fruit to swallow was that state-to-state relations between the Celestial Empire and the barbarians would be conducted on an equal basis. With Western armies at his gates and the Russians pressing on his northeastern borders, the Emperor Xianfeng temporised while he clung to protocol. Foreign envoys might only come as if bearing tribute, travelling along the imperial post roads under escort. They might not ride in sedan chairs or carry weapons, and they would be allowed in only every few years. Fed up with such ineffable intransigence, and enraged by the murder of a group of his negotiators, including a correspondent of the Times of London, Lord Elgin marched on Beijing. The emperor fled, sending his brother, Prince Gong, to parley. In October 1860, the Anglo-French force looted and burnt to the ground the summer palace of the Yuan Ming Yuan, the Gardens of Perfect Brightness, where Lord Macartney had displayed his wares for a more sagacious ruler of China. In the Convention of Beijing, signed by China, Britain, France and Russia on the 24th of October 1860, Britain was awarded the Kowloon Peninsula facing Hong Kong Island in perpetuity. Dissipated and worn out, Xian Feng died at the age of 30 the next summer. Britain had taken Hong Kong Island and the tip of Kowloon through victory in war. The next step of British acquisition would not be formalised for another 38 years, but in the intervening period, China became weaker and weaker. Japan joined the predatory powers around it, the enfeebled Qing dynasty sank into decay, elite reformers failed to save the established order, and Chinese society was convulsed by rebellions and social chaos, while domestic production of opium increased and imports of the drug became less important. By the end of the 19th century, the opium trade no longer played a critical part in the struggle between foreign powers and China, but it has been termed the most long-continued and systematic international crime of modern times. In China, there are frequent calls for Britain to apologise. The closest that any British government has ever come to a semi-official apology was the valedictory speech by the last governor of Hong Kong, Chris Patten, delivered in the dark and the rain at Britain's farewell ceremony, which was not attended by any Chinese leader, on the 30th of June, 1997. This chapter began with events that, from today's vantage point, at the end of the following century, none of us here would wish or seek to condone, Patten said. But we might note that most of those who live in Hong Kong now do so because of events in our own century which would today have few defenders. All that is a reminder that sometimes we should remember the past, the better to forget it. For China, the long 19th century wound to a close with a further humiliation. This time, disaster unfolded through an ill-advised war against Japan for control of Korea. The newly organised Japanese army defeated the Qing forces in a masterful land campaign, and Japan's navy mauled the Chinese fleet. The Qing court sent its leading statesman, Li Hongzhang, to negotiate the Treaty of Shimonoseki, signed on the 17th of April 1895, whose exactions included the loss of Taiwan and part of Manchuria to Japan, acknowledgement of Japanese primacy in Korea, and huge financial indemnities. As the dynasty reeled, France, Germany and Russia compelled it to grant leases of up to 99 years on ports, cities and railways. The Qing dynasty had been a prudent borrower. It had largely used domestic capital to finance its expansion of military arsenals, steelmaking and shipbuilding. Its total foreign debts between 1861 and 1894 have been estimated at around £12 million sterling, principally a British loan syndicated by the Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation at a rate of 5% and a similar loan from a consortium of German banks. In 1895, the imperial finances buckled under the indemnity to Japan. The Qing government faced a payment that has been calculated with interest at £54.5 million. It could not hope to pay such a sum from its own resources. Not the least of its problems was that the payment was fixed in British sterling on the gold standard used by the West, while China itself still computed its revenues on the silver standard. Hapless, the empire had to turn to foreign financiers, setting off a scramble among the powers to finance the indemnity. The City of London, a Franco-Russian syndicate, and the German banks competed to capture the loans. The bankers summoned their diplomats in aid. Count Witte, the Russian foreign minister, believed that financing the Chinese imperial debt gave St. Petersburg leverage to extract railway concessions in Manchuria, built up its prestige at court, and weakened the traditional power of Britain over Chinese affairs. In practice, most of the foreign loans to China up to 1913 passed through the hands of the Hong Kong and Shanghai Bank after the Foreign Office abandoned its Victorian laissez-faire approach and stepped in with diplomatic support. The Hong Kong Bank, too, was a victor of 1895. The winner twice over was Japan. Its military triumph financed the birth of the modern Japanese.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.